Welcome to Sound Bites, hosted by registered dietitian nutritionist Melissa Joy Dobbins. Let's delve into the science, the psychology, and the strategies behind good food and nutrition.
Hello, and welcome to the Sound Bites podcast. Today's episode is about dietary supplements, vitamin and mineral supplements, as well as some others, plus stress, sleep, and immunity. There are nutrient gaps in our lives, and how do we fill those with food and supplements? My guest today is Dr. Susan Hazels Mitmesser. She is the Vice President of Science and Technology at Pharmavite. In that position, Dr. Mitmesser provides scientific leadership to advance innovation and new product development strategies, and to ensure the scientific integrity of all products made under its brand portfolio. She brings extensive experience in research and nutritional biochemistry across various industries and sectors, including food, dietary supplements, academia, and clinical settings. She's been published in many peer-reviewed journals and is a contributing author for book chapters relating to nutrition in adult and pediatric populations. Welcome to the show, Dr. Mitmesser.
Well, hi, Melissa. It's such a pleasure to be here.
Thank you for spending the time to talk with us today. I do want our listeners to know that this episode is sponsored by Nature Made, and Pharmavite is the parent company of Nature Made, and we thank them for their support of the podcast. Before we get into the topic of the day, I would love to hear more about your background and your role at Nature Made.
Well, sure. I have a PhD in nutrition biochemistry, and my role at Pharmavite is really leading a team of fantastic scientists, and these are food scientists, nutrition scientists, RDs, and this team is doing super interesting research that helps people live healthier lives. And what we do is perform all types of different research. We do NHANES analysis. We'll do proof of concept studies in rodent models, all the way through human clinical trials and all that in between. But we not only do biological research, we also do physical research. And this is where the meeting of the biological and physical sciences come together. And what I mean by that is that we do research to understand the physical properties of ingredients and how we can best deliver them. So we identify the best way to get nutrients into the body. And we also know that not all ingredients, nutrients play well together in a formulation. And so we research how best to deliver that for the best outcome for the intended population.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, I'd love to hear more about your research. And I know that there's some consumer insights that you have as well, which I'm always excited to hear about. But maybe you want to tell us about some of the research that you are particularly proud of or interested in right now.
We are really devoted to scientific research. It's the foundation of our company and everything we do. At any given time, we have 30 plus ongoing research projects.
Wow.
And some of this is really to ensure, number one, the quality of our products, but number two, the efficacy and the safety of those products. Mm-hmm. So Nature Made was the first supplement brand to have a USP verified product. And today we have over 60% of our products that are USP verified. And what USP verification really means is it's a third party that verifies the product that ensures that it meets quality criteria for purity and potency. So a lot of our research is dedicated to that, to ensuring the USP verification, but then also the efficacy of the product. There are two recent publications that I'd really like to highlight these pieces of research. One was published in 2020 in PLOS ONE, and it's around the health inequities. And what we found was that there are gender, ethnic, and socioeconomic differences that impact risk for inadequate calcium and vitamin D intakes and osteoporosis risk. Mm. And what was interesting is that we found that non-Hispanic Black males with low income have a 2 times greater increase of risk of developing osteoporosis. Mm. And when you step back and think about that, that's not typically the population that we think is at risk for osteoporosis.
Right.
And so this data is really interesting in that we're diving in more to really figure out how can we address some of these needs for segments of the population.
Mm-hmm.
We also found that there are 2 million annual osteoporosis-related fractures and 19 billion annual U.S. healthcare costs related to these fractures.
Mm.
When you marry those two pieces of data together, the economics of it, plus the segments of the population that we know that are higher risk, it's really information that we can do something with from a public health standpoint.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting.
And a second study that I'd like to highlight is one related to short sleep and micronutrient intake. And this study was published in Nutrients in 2019. And it was the first study to look at usual nutrient intake associations and inadequacies in sleep. And what we found was shortfall micronutrients significantly associated with short sleep are calcium, magnesium, vitamins A, C, D, and E. And that was across the populations. When you segment out the populations, alarmingly, 79% of females 51 years old who experience short sleep have inadequate intake of calcium from food alone.
Mm.
And then individuals in this group also have inadequate intake of other nutrients associated with bone health, such as magnesium, vitamin D, vitamin K. And all of these were significantly associated with short sleep. So in addition to the previous study I highlighted where non-Hispanic Black males had an increased risk, this study in which we found 79% of females had an association with inadequate bone health, vitamins and minerals, it's really interesting to understand how does that association then lead to short sleep or vice versa. Again, was an association, not a causation. So I need to stress that. But this work on the short sleep and micronutrient intake is really setting the foundation for more research within our team. We think this is foundational research for us to pivot and go into really understanding more of the causation than just the association.
So this correlation between these micronutrient deficiencies, and when you say short sleep, I'm assuming that just means people who aren't getting a full night's sleep. Is there a specific definition for short sleep?
Yeah, so this was through NHANES data, and NHANES collects and defines short sleep as less than 6 hours a night.
Okay, yes. And we all know that sleep is essential for good health. So it's really interesting to see these correlations, as you said, you know, not necessarily causations at this point, more research needed, but this correlation between these nutrient gaps or inadequacies and short sleep. So I know that you also, I mentioned earlier, you've got some consumer insights about sleep and stress. I'm always talking about this on the podcast. It's one thing we hear stuff in the news and what the media says, but I often find that what real people are interested in or what's on their radar or what they're looking for or concerned about doesn't always match up to what we see in those headlines. So I always love getting consumer insights. So what would you like to share with us?
Yeah, we recently conducted a survey that explored Americans' health and wellness needs, their goals, and their concerns. And what we found with regard to sleep was sleeping better is top mental health goal for 2021 for half of Americans.
Wow.
So what that means is half of Americans are wanting to improve their sleep. and that's one of their goals for 2021. We also found that 65% of Americans with sleep issues say that those issues negatively impact their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it goes hand in hand with them wanting to improve their sleep quality and quantity for that matter.
Therefore, their quality of life. Absolutely.
Yeah. And when it comes to stress, the survey also addressed some stress issues. And we found that half of Americans say they felt more stressed than ever before,
mm-hmm.
which is probably not surprising given the past 18 months that we've been living in.
Exactly.
And half of Americans report that stress has negatively impacted their physical health and their physical appearance. And what was interesting is that we were able to break down the physical appearance even more. So it wasn't just weight gain, which, you know, was not unexpected. But then there was also things like hair loss and acne and skin problems and things like that that were quite interesting.
And very important to people, absolutely. So in your research and these consumer insights, are you looking at this connection between stress, sleep, and also immunity, and how all of these affect and impact each other?
Yes, this is something that I am super interested in understanding. And what we've learned is that they're interconnected, and it's harder to separate them out and keep them siloed than to connect them. So we're leaning in on that. And sleep, stress, and immunity are the interconnected triad of health and wellness, and each affects the other. So when we're conducting research, we're really trying to understand that a bit better. Mm-hmm. What we do know is that disrupted sleep can affect an optimal immune function. Mm-hmm. And suboptimal immune function disrupts sleep. So there's that connectedness. And then suboptimal immune function can also cause stress. But stress can affect an optimal immune system. So again, that two-way direction of immunity and stress. And stress can also disrupt sleep. We know that disrupted sleep increases fatigue, which diminishes our ability to cope with stress in healthy ways. So you can start to see this cycle where you're not sleeping well, your immune system's compromised, it's increasing your stress level, but stress is causing you to not sleep well in this cycle. It's really something that we need to consider and figure out how we can break the cycle.
Right. And that interconnectivity in this vicious cycle is nothing new, but certainly, as you said, given the pandemic, it's kind of brought it more to the forefront. And certainly people are more interested in and focused on their health and their immune function. So what are some insights or tips that you can enlighten us with when it comes to sleep, stress, immunity, with regard to those nutrient gaps, whether it's diet or supplements? I'd love to hear your insights.
Sure. I'll start with sleep here. Improving sleep is one of the ways we can have the biggest impact on our health, and it's due to that interconnectedness. Building a restorative sleep pattern can lead to significant and meaningful improvements in health. Sleep is important for our immune system because it gives our bodies the chance to repair themselves while also building our immune defense and ability to manage stress. Some of that interconnectedness I spoke about. A central function of sleep is maintaining proper channels of cellular communication in the brain. Sleep is sometimes actually likened to a sort of anti-inflammatory cleansing process where it removes waste products that accumulate during the day. You know, during the day, your brain's firing. And without sleep, those byproducts accumulate and can impair communication. The immune system needs clear communication channels for the cells to appropriately respond. So you can start to almost visualize, if you have an impaired communication, why your immune system may be hindered. One of the interesting things about sleep, and back to some of the consumer insights work that we do, is that we've found that not all sleep problems are the same or created equal. And when you think about sleep issues, a lot of times we focus on the inability to fall asleep. But people also fail to get adequate sleep when they wake up in the middle of the night and they're having trouble falling back to sleep. So some people actually don't have trouble falling asleep. It's the staying asleep part. And there is exogenous melatonin that can help for treatment of sleep problems. However, what we found when you try to solve the problem of staying asleep, immediate release formulations of melatonin, as an example, are rapidly absorbed and cleared within the body and sometimes don't provide the coverage necessary in order to help you stay asleep.
So they might help you fall asleep and not stay asleep or get that restful sleep.
Exactly, exactly. And so when we understood what the consumer need was and the consumer question, we conducted a pharmacokinetic study to determine the right dose of melatonin released at the right time. And so this was foundational for us really understanding how can we formulate something that allows melatonin to break down instantly to help you fall asleep. So melatonin, we showed that melatonin levels rise within the first 15 minutes. But then we applied a extended release technology to the remaining part of the melatonin in the formulation. So the melatonin is slowly released over 6 hours. And so what that does is it helps you stay asleep. It's a really nice combination. This is a fantastic example as to where we're really leaning in a bit more to understand the pharmacokinetic profile of something that's commonly used, such as melatonin.
Yeah, very interesting. And you know, of course, with like good sleep hygiene, I believe is the phrase that we hear, you know, there's certain things that, as with everything, like a supplement isn't going to fix your bad habits. You need to have some good sleep habits. I believe I've heard you don't want to exercise before. I have no trouble falling asleep. Sometimes I have trouble staying asleep, but I think that's hormonal related. But and it gets worse as I get older. But you know, we want to make sure we're not exercising or eating or screen time like right before bedtime. Also, alcohol, you know, can disrupt sleep. But do you want to speak a little bit to the good sleep hygiene and then with regard to the supplement like melatonin?
Sure, absolutely. So a couple of things that can really help, just foundational for good sleep, is make sure you're exercising. Try to eat as close to a balanced diet as you possibly can. And one simple thing is putting devices away before bed and ideally an hour plus before you go to bed. What I always recommend is that you do a little bit of self-reflection. If you're having trouble sleeping, figure out what is your sleep issue. Is it that your mind's racing and you simply cannot fall asleep? Well, that's something we can address. We can figure out, okay, what can help your mind relax and develop a routine that is more of a ritual for you to start to relax end of day? Or is it similar to what we previously spoke about and you have no problem falling asleep, but you wake up in the middle of the night and you simply cannot fall back asleep? Trying to figure out the solve for that is what we're really dedicated to doing.
Right. I remember thinking when this started happening to me, usually it's like 3 a.m. or something like that. And I think, yeah, it's not that typical what you would think where I've got all these things on my mind. I'm pretty good about just putting that aside. And I was like, I'm just kind of laying here. I just can't get back to sleep and I'm not stressed about it. But I could just literally get up and start my day, which obviously I did not want to create that habit. 3 a.m. is a little bit too early to do that. So that's really interesting. What about the connection between like stress and diet? Obviously, we know, again, like a balanced diet helps manage stress, but stress can cause changes in our eating habits, you know, stress eating, restriction, things like that. Is there anything that you've seen in your research or insights with regard to nutrients and stress and, you know, whether it's diet or supplements?
Yeah. So stress can have a negative impact on a lot of different attributes of our life, the immune system and interrupting your sleep patterns. But stress is kind of viewed like inflammation. It's linked to a lot of adverse outcomes and is considered a general health risk, but it's sometimes difficult to define and treat. Again, I always go back to self-reflection. You know, in managing stress, start with a great foundation. So are you exercising? And are there times in the day when you find that you're more stressed and then you can potentially exercise or go out for a walk? There is research that shows that being out in nature actually does decrease stress. So simply going outside and getting fresh air may help. And make sure that you have a balanced diet. And you mentioned this earlier in that stress eating. So even though you're stressed, try to make it a habit of not impacting your diet and, you know, still dedicate the time that you typically do to making dinner or making meals for you and or your family so that you're not doing quote unquote stress eating.
Mm-hmm.
But there also are some supplements that can help mediate stress, such as L-theanine. And so that's something that if just as a supplement to supplement the diet to help you start to manage some of your stress.
Okay. I haven't heard of that one. Well, it sounds like with sleep, stress, and immunity, there's just a lot going on and there's different causes. So there's different solutions, you know, you mentioned different sleep issues. Certainly with stress, yeah, it could be a lot of different causes and a lot of different solutions. What about immunity? Are there certain vitamins and minerals or supplements or, you know, one thing that I, you know, with the pandemic and everything, we started seeing all this stuff about boosting immunity. And I kind of was like, we got to be careful about, you know, talking to people about boosting immunity. And I came across this phrase that I'm much more comfortable with. I think it's more accurate and more helpful for people is to support a healthy immune system. So we don't want to by any means, you know, be like, go out and take all these supplements and that'll fix your immune issues. But obviously we know that there are vitamins and minerals that are really important for immunity. So I'd love to hear you talk about that.
Your diet absolutely has an impact on our immune health. There are five vitamins and minerals important for immunity, those being vitamin A, C, D, E, and zinc. And all those have complementary roles within how our immune system functions. And one of the things we probably forget is that we're continually faced and threats against our immune system. But thankfully, our immune system acts as the body's operating system, which means that it's always on and there to help protect your body from an infection or a disease. And so knowing the two parts, the primary parts of the immune system, the innate immune system and the adaptive immune system, think of the innate immune system as the guards that are there to protect your body. Barrier functions, so things like the skin. If the invader gets past the guards, that's when the adaptive immune system or the soldiers start to kick in and recognize that the invader is indeed foreign and starts to release things to attack the invader. And that's where these vitamins and minerals really help to complementary degrees of ensuring that the innate and the adaptive immune system are very well armed. So what you can do to ensure, knowing that those are the vitamins and minerals that are super helpful for your immune system, is, again, I'll go back to self-reflection. Think about what foods are most common to have vitamins A, C, D, E, and zinc. And are there foods that you eliminate, therefore you may not be getting that micronutrient. So as an example, let's say I'm lactose intolerant, and so I don't eat a lot of dairy. If so, I may be shorting myself on vitamin D. So how do I ensure that I put vitamin D back into my diet? And that's where a supplement does just what it's supposed to do, is supplement the diet because I'm not getting it via food.
Right. And specifically with vitamin D, I've said this on the podcast before, I think the research and the learnings that we've seen in my career lifetime about vitamin D are probably the most interesting and significant that I've seen in my career. Now, I used to work for the Dairy Council and I knew, well, there's only so much vitamin D in food, whether it's naturally occurring or fortified. And certainly we get vitamin D from the sun, but you know, I'm in Chicago. I don't get that much sun. So vitamin D, I think, is a particularly interesting supplement or nutrient because we know it's very hard, if not impossible, to get it all through food. And so it's been interesting to see the evolution of, you know, people getting their vitamin D levels checked and taking a supplement to make sure that it stays within an acceptable range. And then things like zinc. I can never remember what foods are rich in zinc, but that's one of the vitamins and minerals that you mentioned for immunity that I think is really interesting as well.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on the vitamin D initiative that's gone on over the last 10 plus years. It's fascinating to see where it's gone. And wouldn't it be fantastic if we could go and get the level of other micronutrients checked to ensure that we have proper status? Mm-hmm. That's going to be the sweet spot for personalized nutrition when we can go in and get beyond just vitamin D testing to ensure that we're up to par, but then other micronutrients. And I think there's a lot of really interesting personalized ways to think about nutrition in the future.
You know, some people, including some of my health professional peers, don't take or don't recommend taking supplements because, you know, this food first and, you know, get it from the diet. And my personal philosophy is, well, that's a great goal, but, you know, may not be realistic as we've been talking. So I would love to hear what you say to people who are kind of saying, well, supplements, you know, we don't really need them. You know, we just get it from food. What do you say to those people?
Yeah, first and foremost, Melissa, you and I share a very similar philosophy in that try to get all your nutrients from food. And that's always first and foremost. However, if you find you can't, you shouldn't feel like you failed. Mm-hmm. I think that's really key in that I think understanding where the gaps are just arms you with information and knowledge so then you can fill the gaps, however is best suited for you. But there are several reasons why you may not be able to get everything you need from your diet or from food. One being that specialized diets in and of themselves may inadvertently cause inadequate dietary intake. Mm-hmm. I'll give you an example. If I follow a gluten-free diet, because of the foods I am eliminating from my diet, there's a high probability I'm lacking vitamin D, B12, folate, iron, magnesium, calcium, and zinc. Mm-hmm. And think about those, which we just talked about, in relationship to our conversation on immunity. A lot of those overlap.
Yeah, absolutely.
Another example is, what if I don't like fish? I don't necessarily have an allergy, but if I eliminate fish from my diet, we all know that omega-3 fatty acids, it's one of the most heavily studied food ingredients. And there are many known benefits throughout life stages, everywhere from infancy all through the aging adult. So if I know I'm eliminating fish, I need to figure out how can I best supplement my diet to get the omega-3 benefit.
Right.
Nutrient deficiencies in the food supply are also becoming more and more common, unfortunately. So as we modify foods, you know, seedless grapes, seedless watermelons, we've decreased the micronutrients in those foods, but increased the macronutrients. And a lot of times it's the sugar content that we've increased during the modification of the food itself.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So it begs the question, you know, how do we ensure that we're getting the right micronutrients from our food historically, when we historically could get all that vitamin C from an orange? Maybe we're not so much now. A couple other areas that may drive a lack of a micronutrient in your diet is just full allergies or intolerances. Mm-hmm. I mentioned being lactose intolerant, which if you're lactose intolerant and you're eliminating dairy from your food repertoire, there's a high probability you're lacking calcium and vitamin D. Mm-hmm. And this goes back to some of the previous research we talked about, the health inequities within calcium and vitamin D, but then also vitamin D's role in the immune system. And then finally, there are nutrient drug interactions. As we get older, the reliance on pharmaceutical or OTC drugs increases. And there are common drugs that cause an interaction with a nutrient, such as antacids. Mm-hmm. They can cause an interaction with magnesium and B12. Mm-hmm. So if you're on an antacid, you probably want to consider taking magnesium and B12 supplementation to ensure you're getting enough. Mm-hmm. Another one that sometimes is overlooked is just oral contraceptives. oral contraceptives can cause a depletion of folic acid, B6, and magnesium. Mm. And what we do know is magnesium's heavily involved in a lot of body systems in the human body. And so making sure that you have enough magnesium is super critical.
Interesting. And then with the pandemic, we also saw a huge increase in food insecurity. So if we have the best intentions, but we're on a limited budget or we're food insecure, obviously that can lead to nutrient gaps as well.
Yes, it's a fantastic point. I mean, there's a such thing as a food desert where people just don't have access to high quality food. And, you know, this whole stuffed and starved phenomenon where people are eating heavily processed foods with low quality micronutrient density. And it's a pity to be where we are with all of our technologies and we still can't get the right nutrients to everybody in our country. It really is it's a pity.
Right. And certainly if somebody's food insecure and on a limited budget, you know, supplements aren't free, obviously, but it's leading to the worsening of this situation. So as we're having this conversation, you know, some of the common questions that come up, obviously, do we need supplements? Are they safe? Are they effective? You've given some perfect examples and illustrations of when we might need certain supplements. And I know that in different life stages, we have different nutrient needs. So is there anything that you wanted to share with us about different points in the lifespan that might have, you know, obviously we don't have hours and hours on and to talk about every life stage and all the different nutrients, but is there anything that stands out to you that is really important that you want to share?
Yes, I do think we could do a whole session on just a couple of these, but I'll just highlight two that I think are really important and underplayed. One is choline during early fetal development. So choline is a vitamin-like structure, and it's a structural component of all cell membranes. During pregnancy, you have this window of opportunity for choline to help with fetal brain development, and it also helps with liver and placental function. A derivative of choline is betaine, and it's a methyl donor needed for DNA during fetal development. And it's involved in the regulation of gene expression, cell differentiation, and organ formation. So stepping back from what I just said and think about just the developing fetus and not having choline present can really have an impact on that fetal development. Another is calcium during adolescence and young adulthood. While calcium does get quite a bit of airplay, we don't talk a lot about peak bone mass. Peak bone mass is achieved in the early 20s. Mm-hmm. And so you can build bone mass through, you know, your early 20s, but usually we focus on young children getting enough calcium and vitamin D to build their peak bone mass. But we don't think about adolescents and young adults continuing to build that peak bone mass, because once you reach the peak bone mass, it's going downhill from there. Mm-hmm. And so there's no opportunity to increase your peak bone mass once you've reached that age. And so I just think that's a fantastic opportunity that is sometimes overlooked in adolescence and young adulthood.
Mm-hmm. Yes, certainly. I did a lot of work in that area when I worked for the Dairy Council. And you're right. They would say, you know, you're depositing into that bank and then you're trying to prevent the losses and maintain what you have. And you know, we tend to forget that sometimes. And I've talked about choline on the podcast before, and there's a recent episode. We get into that nutrient a little bit. There's a lot of exciting research going on with choline right now, and the dietary guidelines having the first time ever addressing birth to 24 months has been exciting as well.
Yes, I really love talking about the first 1,000 days of life. There's so many critical opportunities that we have as a society to give children really the best start in life.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. One more quick question about supplements. You know, you mentioned the USP. So this is kind of bringing us full circle to the beginning. You know, sometimes people are concerned that what the vitamin label says or mineral, you know, supplement label says is not necessarily what's in it, or maybe there's things in it that shouldn't be in it. Can you speak a little bit more about the safety and the quality?
Yes. Unfortunately, there are some bad actors in the supplement world. And honestly, consumers should be skeptical because they have the right and they should want to know what they're putting into their bodies. And that's really why we place such an emphasis on having our products verified by a third party, a highly reputable third party at that, in the USP, which has stringent quality criteria for purity and potency. And what that really boils down to is USP ensures that what we put in the bottle is on the label and it's accurate and you're getting it through shelf life. You know, that's another thing that sometimes goes underlooked. So look at the expiration date of these things. They degrade over time. And USP ensures that what we put in the bottle is in the bottle, but also it's in the bottle through shelf life.
That's a great point.
Another point is the attention to science. Not all players in the dietary supplement space are dedicated to really adding to the totality of scientific knowledge. And we pride ourselves on that. We reinvest in research because ultimately we want to improve the betterment of our society and doing that through proper nutrition. When you have proper nutrition, you can learn better. You can function better in your day job. You have healthier outlook on life. So there are just so many halo effects you get from having better nutrition.
Absolutely. Well, you know, when it comes to diet and lifestyle, there's so many different factors involved. And so we always recommend that people sit down with a registered dietitian and a healthcare professional to kind of look at different areas of their diet or lifestyle that might need some attention. So I assume it's similar with supplements. You know, how do you recommend that people go about figuring out if they need a supplement, and if so, which ones?
I recommend exactly what you just said. Do self-reflection and then reach to your healthcare professional that can help you best. So try to understand your diet so you can articulate that to a registered dietitian, and then they can help you fill in the gaps, whether it's shifting timing of meals or whether it's adding a couple, swapping a few foods out, and or recognizing that you're eliminating a food group or a food item that is super great quality of a micronutrient that you probably are missing in your diet, and then filling that nutrient gap with a high quality supplement. So that's first and foremost, is using your resources, you know, understand what you're doing, and then reaching out to your registered dietitian to help you really pinpoint and personalize it.
Right. And I want to put a finer point on the registered dietitian aspect of it. I'm not going to throw physicians under the bus here, but they don't know food like dietitians do. And if a dietitian is looking at your diet, she or he can identify those nutrient gaps. And, you know, we've all heard, oh, my vitamin D level is low, so my doctor told me to take, you know, a certain amount that that person might have already been taking, or the vitamin D level was so low that they might have needed a higher dose to bring it back up into that area. So I think dietitians are a little more well-versed in that area. So that's my plug.
I would agree 100%. You're trained to understand foods and how they impact the human body.
Right. Well, as we're wrapping up, I would love to hear if there's anything you're able to share with us about future research and what that looks like at NatureMade.
I'm really fascinated by the plant kingdom. There are millions of plant compounds found in nature, and 99% have yet to be discovered. So we're embarking on research to better understand the fundamental link between plants, human health, and nutrition. Combine that with the fact that we are learning that sometimes it's the metabolite of something that has a health benefit. So really looking at some of those metabolites and understanding how, when we break them down in our gut with all the different bacteria in our gut, that metabolite may be what is actually having the health benefit. An example is when you think about prebiotic fibers. And the prebiotic fiber, we're finding, you know, there are short chain fatty acids that come from those fibers that are broken down within the gut. And butyrate is a fantastic example where we're finding that the butyrate itself, so the metabolite, is having the health benefit. So I just think there's a world of opportunity within the plant kingdom, and then how our gut actually metabolizes these things and how it gives us a benefit to our health.
Very interesting. And coincidentally, I did an episode on the gut microbiome, and we talked about short chain fatty acids and butyrate. I believe it's episode 168. I'll put a link to that in my show notes as well. So yeah, really fascinating. Thank you for sharing that.
Great. Thank you.
Where can people find more information about vitamin, mineral, other supplements? Is there a Nature Made website? Are you guys on social media?
Yes, we're on social media. The naturemade.com website is a fantastic resource for healthcare professionals as well as consumers. Gives a lot of great information on just basic nutrition, but also helping to identify what you as an individual may need in your diet.
Great. Yeah. And I think you guys are on Instagram and Facebook, and I will have links to all of this in my show notes. In addition to some of the research that you talked about, I believe I have the links to some of those studies. You mentioned naturemade.com has a healthcare practitioner section as well. So thank you for sharing all of that and for being here and talking with us today about such an important topic.
Oh, it was my pleasure, Melissa. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you. And for everybody listening, as always, enjoy your food and supplements with health in mind. Till next time.
For more information, visit soundbitesrd.com. Music by Dave Burke, produced by JAG and Detroit Podcasts.